Randolph Hawkins, also known as the father of the tenor sax, the little number that he composed in 1948, I should say recorded in 1948, called Picasso. This music was used in a feature film called South of the Moon. I'm about to call him Picasso. I mean, Hawkins. Hawkins died in 1969 of liver disease at the age of 64. This is Leid Stories. I'm Eutrice Leid. And what a weekend this has been, news-wise. Lots and lots and lots of things happening. Make your head spin. But I guess we could start with a very interesting observation about what seems to be a change, a discernible change in the tone of news coverage when it comes to Trump and the White House. Have you noticed it? I was taken aback by the intensity and the no mincing of words. It was the most I've seen from the media in terms of what Trump would call negative coverage. And I'm wondering, what caused it? I mean, it's unusual when news organizations kind of have the same echoing each other, it seems, in terms of their attitudes toward Trump and his administration. But boy, oh boy, it was rough this weekend. Trump had no place to hide. And it seemed that the major media had turned the corner on Trump attitudinally, and the coverage reflected an attitude I haven't seen in a long time in the press. So we'll talk about that. What does that mean? What does it signify? As you know, Trump has just completed his appearance at the G7 summit in France. And even there, the feeling wasn't good. The coverage wasn't positive about him. And there were clear indications that he was not exactly warmly received by the members of the summit, participating in the summit. So what do you think is happening? What accounts for this? It seemed all of a sudden somebody, you know, flicked a switch and there was a torrent of media coverage critical, very critical of the president and his administration. I'll read you some examples of what ran this weekend. We have on MSNBC, one right after the other, you have former Representative Joe Walsh, who is singing songs like he wants to take on Trump in the primary. Quote, I apologize for my role in putting unfit Trump in the White House. That's quite a thing to say, especially as a pitch to the voting public that he's looking for support to topple Trump. But to say it that way, that's unusual. I see another one here. I'm trying to just get this whole thing under control. How, you know, I'm not all that adept at computer things. Beto O'Rourke says, Trump has given racism a new life. Chris Matthews says, with tax cut failure and the polls, indicating the polls that were negative for Trump, Trump is acting like a loser. I mean, they're not even mincing words. They're not being delicate. Trump's days-long public meltdown has moved from words to actions. Wow. Members of the G7 hoping to minimize the chances of a Trump disruption. No comfort to be found for Trump in recent polling. But there's one other that I want to read to you because it just absolutely doesn't cover anything up. This is a quote from former White House Communications Director Anthony Scaramucci. He says, the president is having a total mental breakdown. And that's just from one main source. Markets tank after wild Trump tweets. Aides alarmed by erratic Trump behavior. What voters are saying about impeachment. And these do not come from wild people, you know, just talking off the top of their heads. These are people who have known or have worked or have covered Donald Trump for at least since he's been in office. So I want to ask you, what is this sudden turn on Donald Trump or the amping up of criticism and attacks on Trump? What do you think is the reason for it? 888-874-4888 is the number to call. Let's start there today. What could possibly be the reason that all of a sudden we're seeing these kinds of critical comments and judgments and pronouncements against Trump? What happened? What caused it? And what do you think? Are you okay with it, or are you troubled by it? What is your reaction to this very strange and sudden turn in the tone of coverage of the president and his administration? What does it signal for the immediate future, if you have thoughts about that? 888-874-4888. I wanted to tackle this because it was just so pronounced over the weekend. It's as if any news feed that you get, this was the tone. And it comes, again, right after the G7 summit. And it seemed also to gather up some other things. You know, they put in other things that they have been covering. And I had not seen in a long time, I had not seen the media so outspoken, so frank in expressing its thoughts and the thoughts of others as frankly as this. So it must mean something is going on or something is about to happen. And they sense it and they're getting ahead of it. What do you think it is? 888-874-4888 is the number to call. I want to ask this question because, sometimes we don't actually stop and analyze what media coverage is all about. What is it doing? What is its function? And then you see something like this, and you see it happening on this station or on that radio station or in the newspapers, and you're getting a sense of consensus of opinion being formed. This is not to say that it is unanimous by any means. There are media outlets, of course, that still strongly support the president. But we're talking about a kind of gelling of opinion. Does it strike you as odd or newsworthy that we're seeing a barrage directed at Donald Trump and copious amounts of coverage, basically carrying that tone, essentially anti-Trump? What does it mean? Any thoughts? 888-874-4888. Or else we'll just move on. I think this is a very interesting development because I hadn't seen this level of vitriol. I don't know if vitriol is the right word or intense coverage, but not in favor of the incumbent. I'd never seen it recently, certainly. They cover the president in a particular way, and they talk about, the summits and what came out of it and what is going into it, as this president leaves to attend any particular summit. You get that kind of backgrounder information and so forth. But this was different. This was, to me, a kind of watershed moment in terms of coverage of the president and his administration and the attitudes, reflecting the attitudes of the voting public and of the media outlets that have been covering Donald Trump since, of course, he took office. This is the first time I've seen this overall. The coverage was not in his favor. All right, so we'll move on. I also wanted to talk about the Cherokee Nation of 370,000 people has made it known that it intends to have a federal seat, a seat in Congress. And this, they say, is in accordance with a 200-year-old treaty that they had agreed to with the federal government 200 years ago, and it never materialized. Do you think it is, considering that they have survived 200 years without joining a Congress that in fact had annihilated them, attacked them, killed off so many of them? Is it something that they should want? having proved that 200 years have passed and they still have survived as a nation. What do you think is behind the insistence of getting what they are owed by treaty? Will this administration yield to that demand? Will Congress grant that demand? How do you see the scenario developing? 888-874-4888. That's my second topic for the day. The third topic is, of course, what happened in Florida. The Stand Your Ground case came to an end with a conviction. There was a conviction in this case. As you know, this was a case, a very controversial case. A man, I got a call. So let's take the call. We'll get back to that in a minute. Patricia from New York, you're on the air.
Hello?
Hi, Patricia. You're on the air.
Hi. Good afternoon, Eutrice. I hope all is well, and good afternoon to the PRN family. I just want
to
go back
to you, too. Good afternoon to you.
Your first question, and then proceed with the issue with the Cherokee Nation, because I literally just finished about 5 minutes ago reading about that. But, you know, I watched the entire G7 coverage this weekend, and I listened to President Trump's press conference this morning. And I think what's happening, and I could be mistaken, but, you know, in the past, the press has sacrificed their integrity to have access, you know, to press conferences and to the president. But, you know, when you listen to the coverage this weekend, as you correctly state, the tone and the tenor had changed, including this morning. You know, Yamiche Alcindor from PBS literally challenged his comment that the reason Putin was ejected from the G8 was because he had this, you know, problem with President Obama. And she literally not only called that statement incorrect, she literally called it a lie, which is something that would never have occurred previously. And I think the press itself is beginning to recognize that they have literally been complicit in allowing Trump to proceed as he has done. And I think they're beginning to make an attempt to correct that.
I agree. But what else? As you broaden your scope and you look at the tone and tenor, as you put it, of foreign nations.
Well, you know, the other sense that I got, and I literally watched the reception that he and the First Lady received by all of the other dignitaries, it was really very cool. And it was clear that that Trump was literally isolated. You know, even though he protested too much about unity, he was literally on the outside looking in. And I think he felt it.
I think so, too.
They have decided that they've got to proceed because this man is crazy. And they've got to proceed in their self-interest. And they were not going to be deterred, and they were not going to let him disrupt this meeting. And rightfully so.
What do you think the response by Trump will be? Especially, well, we had Scaramucci saying openly that Trump is in full-blown meltdown. If that is accurate, what should be happening now within the Trump administration?
Okay, so those are two questions. Number one, I look at somebody like Scaramucci and I look at somebody like Joe Walsh, and I would characterize them as opportunists. They were complicit in allowing this man to come into office. So for them to criticize him now, the criticism is correct, but the messenger is the wrong person to send this message. So that's number one. But number two, if, in fact, they truly believe that this is a situation, they need to be employing that Article 25, you know, removing him from office because he is not capable. That's the next step if they truly believe that.
Who will do that, though?
Well, that's a good question. Who's got the cojones to do that?
Who will do that?
I don't know, you trees. Like I said, who's got the cojones? I don't know it. I can't identify anybody. It would seem to me that this would be an opportune time for the Democrats, especially now that the psychiatric community is becoming more vocal about this. Over the weekend, they were very clear that this man was unstable. So why are the Democrats not taking up the mantle and saying, okay, we have medical experts who have now identified a problem. What do we do to solve it?
Well, they have identified the problem, but they also clearly have stated that they have not themselves examined Trump.
Wait a minute. The psychiatric community has made an observation based on their knowledge of the criteria. What more do you need?
He has to be examined.
And who is going to objectively certify? If you remember, when he had his last physical, did his physician, I think under duress, I could be mistaken, certify that this man was in physical, good physical and emotional and psychiatric health? But you now have experts coming out and saying otherwise. So what medical person is going to certify that? I'm talking about impartial medical person.
Well, this is where we are, because Trump's own personal physician, if you remember, he admitted that Trump dictated the letter.
Exactly.
Affirming his good health.
Exactly.
And he signed it, which should have caused him to lose his license immediately.
Exactly.
But we have a dilemma. People are seeing it. We saw this a long time ago, and we called it. That's 2 years ago.
But you treat
it.
Yes, we're the Democrats on this.
The
impeachment is over. That's not going to happen. The timeline just does not allow for that. But then they have another option now.
Well, I don't know, because Nancy Pelosi is also becoming more and more vocal about her resistance and her opposition, I should say, to removing Donald Trump, impeaching Donald Trump, and removing him from office. She's adamant about it. She has not changed her mind. In fact, she has become even more determined to persuade the Democrats to do nothing with regard to impeachment just yet.
I think the time for that discussion is past. The timeline does not permit it, which is what she wanted all along.
Exactly. Exactly. I agree with that. So, again, the people get screwed. We're in the middle. And we have to live with a situation, or we being made to live with a situation we deplore. And in terms of Nancy Pelosi, I would say it's a very personal decision, but she should not have a monopoly on these kinds of decisions, although we see movement by the rest of the Democrats that they are moving ahead. Will they be able to cinch a vote for impeachment, to proceed with a formal impeachment overriding Nancy Pelosi or not? I mean, it is just so crazy. I see the tone of the coverage by media outlets as a signal. They want him gone. They finally are admitting, at least to themselves, he's an embarrassment to the country. He has messed up just about every standing treaty and agreement that the United States has worked out. I think it was started by Trump as a backlash to Obama. He's that petty. He's that silly. He doesn't want anything on the record to stand as being, as originating with the Obama presidency. So he's busy dismantling everything, even things that are very good for the country. So this is a very interesting issue. But I couldn't get away from, I couldn't get over the fact that the media, this weekend, things turned. Things turned. Now, whether this is a permanent feeling or would take some, it would get some traction, or whether this was just a momentary thing and just so happened that most of the media covering Trump came to this conclusion, these conclusions, I should say. I don't know. But I thought it was significant, the tone and the universality of opinion and the tone that it took. Thanks, Patricia, for calling in.
Hello?
888-874-4888. What is going on? Patricia was right on the button with her observations. But what are your observations? What do you think this means? And do you think that it is being overrated? Am I overreacting? Or is this just a momentary blip and it would go back to the way it was before? Or did something happen this past weekend, that we should pay attention to, because I think it's meant to send a signal. And the signal is, we've had it with this president, and he has got to go. We have it from Wall Street. The reaction from Wall Street is that the stocks are suffering, the prices of stocks suffering. Trump is causing a depression. In fact, we have predictions that we are practically on the edge of a recession. And it wouldn't take long for a full-blown recession to hit us. And how the stocks worldwide, they're blaming Trump for depressing the markets with his off-the-cuff statements, his careless and reckless decisions, which he makes into law. He's talking now about, he has the, and he quotes, I quote him, the absolute right. He's an absolutist president. He has the absolute right to do the crazy things that he's doing. And he shouldn't be questioned. Even if everybody is holding their heads and running in the streets screaming that the sky is falling, he insists they are wrong. They don't know what they're doing, and they don't appreciate a good president. In almost every sphere of influence where he has interfered arbitrarily and recklessly, he has caused so much damage. And now people are reacting, because it seems as if the president is completely out of control. Scaramucci's quote, he's a loudmouth too, so he appreciates it. in Trump, but he's trying to tell us, you got to trust me, look at me differently, and hear what I'm saying. The man is in a full-blown meltdown. He said it. A full-blown meltdown. Well, do you just chalk it up to the fact that he's, you know, loud and he craves attention as well, and he comes out of the world of look at me, and Trump is a little bit down, so this is his opportunity, Scaramucci's opportunity, to rise above and put himself on the map to wherever it is he wants to go. But we should we just ignore this as personal shots that people are taking? Or is there something serious behind all of this? Bill from Brooklyn, what do you say?
Good afternoon, Utrice. Yes,
hello.
It's quite... Hello.
Yes.
I think one of the things, it comes down to, as most things globally, money. I think at last all of the markets are showing that this erratic behavior on the part of Trump is really having a potentially very long-term effects. And at last, the media has at least voluntarily begun to really speak out on this in terms of what has been self-evident from day one. And so it's really impacting, it's even his supporters, the farmers that were so staunchly for him, and the whole trade wars, and is at war with the world. And it's finally to a head, and I think the media and the leaders around the world and people continue.
Oh, you went a little bit out for a moment. We couldn't hear what you were saying.
Oh, I'm sorry. I was saying basically that it's just gotten to a point where things are not sustainable with this president, and the whole world recognizes it, especially the global markets.
Somebody's trying to send a message, and to whom? Who is trying to send a message?
To send a message. I think also the people have been screaming about this for years now, ever since he's been in. It's just come to a head, and I've just realized that this is not sustainable, and it's come to, at least it has to be out on these things.
So that puts even greater focus on the upcoming elections.
Absolutely.
What do you think is likely to happen? Who will emerge as
this, at least this
It's a spirit. I'm not hearing you, Bill. All right. Let's try Ernie from New York. You're on the air.
Hello.
Hello, Ernie. You're on the air.
Hi. Thanks for taking my call, Utrice.
Thank you.
One thing that I've been noticing. One thing that I've been noticing in some of the newspapers, like the New York Times and the Google News, et cetera, is that they're talking more about a recession now, and it's not just being, you know, put to the side. They are talking about possible recession coming.
Yes.
The issue with the trade war going and coming with China. China not backing out. In fact, China just digging deeper into, you know, their feet ground into the ground deeper. They're playing with something that they got to be very careful with that, because we depend a lot on Chinese imports. I mean, I was at Burlington store, and pretty much everything that's in there, including clothes and some of the hardware stuff, the electronics, little tiny handy-dandy thing. It's all made in China. I mean, I went to Macy's the other day. I looked at a shirt that was $50-something. Usually you can get it for $3 or $5, $10 the most. They had it for $50-something. Tommy Hilfiger. Made in China. So we move in, it's moving into an area that is, they can't back out once this, it's going to be kind of hard. It'll take maybe years if a recession starts. So I think that's what they're looking at. That's just my viewpoint here. I don't have much to say today, Yutris. I just want to hang up on this.
Well, thank you so much. Bye. Thank you.
Bye.
Thanks for calling in. Albert from New Jersey, you're on the air.
Hi, Yutris. Thank you for taking my call. Got a little different take. I'm sorry.
I said thanks for calling. Yes, I could hear you.
Albert. Okay. I got a little different take on what may be causing or generating this backlash. And that is, there's something very subtle going on here. If you look at any of those clips after the G7...
Albert, could you just turn off your radio for a moment, because I'm getting feedback.
Oh, you know what? I'm sorry. I didn't realize I had it on. Let me just click this. And how's that?
That's fine.
Good. Oh, I have an interesting take on this. It just occurred to me. Two things happened. The look that these foreign leaders have given to Trump says more than you can ever say.
What was that look?
Right?
Yeah.
I wouldn't be surprised if you're getting all kinds of heat from public officials, and this is one of the reasons it's driving the press to take second looks at this. This man is a total wreck. And these other governmental officials, I don't think they can believe what they're looking at. And the kind of contempt that the Chinese had just looking at that guy, it's almost as if, you know, if you don't do something about him, we're going to do something about him. And I wouldn't be surprised if you could get into some of those communications between foreign dignitaries and what's going on in this country. They probably already issued an ultimatum to these people. This guy's got to go. I mean, this man is just wreaking havoc over everything. For instance, with China. I mean, nobody wants to talk about the amount of money and debt that the Chinese have bought up from us. And this guy's actually had the goal to sit there and say, well, I'm sorry, I didn't raise the tariffs higher. This man is out of control. And I think you're getting a lot of backlash from public officials. And if you could get to some of those back channels, I'll bet you they're putting so much heat on the press about, you know, what it is. And they're probably just restraining themselves. Look at the Russians. Putin, he's going right ahead and making sure that there are Russian warships surrounding Venezuela. And the U.S. is just mad enough to keep pushing Trump's troops down there. But it's my take on it. But I think that has a lot to do with what's going on. The press realizes that it isn't just America that they've been lying to. But these other dignitaries realize it, too, and realize this guy is out for a war and is closer to pushing us to a nuclear holocaust than you can even imagine. And it probably, I would say, like I said, there's a lot of communications going back and forth. You got to get rid of this guy. He's got to go. That's my viewpoint.
Well, okay, but how does that explain? Are you suggesting that what is happening now is that there's a confluence of interests, political, the media, the private sector, Wall Street? Are people loosely forming connections here with that very thing in mind, making sure he's gone from office?
I would say yes, because here's the thing. I would agree with that concept and the whole idea of this kind of zeitgeist which is going on now. The press has been notorious, as we've all realized. But these guys have finally come around to realizing they're on a ship that's got a lot of holes in it and no bilge pumps to get it out. And I think that you can say what you want, you can prop this guy up, but there's nothing there anymore to prop it up. I mean, how long can you keep telling somebody that red is blue and really think they're going to believe it after a while? The revenues are down, and the other one of the other callers was saying, and I agree with, this guy's worn hell with the stock market. And one of the indicators is that, you know, the price of gold has been stable for years, and it's kind of tied into the economic markets. The more unsuccessful they are, or the more in chaos they look, the more the gold goes up. Now, I just started buying gold about a year ago, and you can see it. Every weekend, I mean, they got daily gold charts. You look at them. Every time this guy opens his mouth, the price goes up. He's totally disrupted the whole deal. And that's why I say I think we got some serious problems. But I think there's a turning in the corner because you can't hide for so long. And I think my man has just about used up all of his ability to have Teflon.
But, you know, he has survived. I mean, with everything that we know and all that has happened, he still survived.
Oh, yes, I agree with that. He has.
But again, notice you said survived. Requires a political action, which doesn't seem to be happening fast enough.
Well, a lot of times things don't appear to be happening fast. But I got to tell you, as you observed, that turn you saw this weekend, that's a monumental thing. That's a monumental turn. Because now what is the press going to do? Turn around tomorrow and tell you after they lied to you, then they're going to turn around and say, well, oh, we really didn't mean it. I mean, he's really a good guy, but we just had a bad weekend. No, I don't think so. I think that zeitgeist and that ability to, you know, get rid of everything has just turned on Mr. Trump. And I think that you're only going to see it all go downhill. I mean, let's face it. Look at his approval number, 60%. Man, they were ready to get rid of, who was it, Bush Jr.? Before he started his war, this guy had the lowest approval ratings. they're unbelievable.
According to the latest poll, it's even higher than 62%. It's now in the 70s.
Yes, and this is some of our, and I've used the word before, cognizant dissonance, that, you know, they use the word higher. Well, higher actually means lower. 30% approval rating is what it means. That's just outright crazy. you just can't get along with that for so long. And I think, and I'm glad that this is beginning to run its course. And you're going to see a lot of problems. And yes, we're on the heels of a depression, and it's coming because look at the banks. They're bigger than they ever were. They got the same problems that they had before, but they just can't buy their way out of it because there's just not enough money to go around, and they can't print that much either. I mean, when you start talking about things like negative interest rates, that you're going to buy bonds, get paid less for them just to have a bank hold them, what kind of craziness is that? And the interest rates are already so low, they can't drop them anymore. The whole world is topsy-turvy, and this guy is just running around like, well, you know, it's all beautiful. And I don't think it is all beautiful. I think we're in for some tough times, Eutrice. But I just a real quickie, please, if I may take a minute. I saw something this weekend that reinforced my concept of dissonance. In Michigan, they had this town meeting. This woman sat there and said, I think this community ought to be kept white. Now, yes. that itself didn't particularly bother me, but she was sitting with all the council members. And the council members, I mean, you could see them just I'll be squirming in their seats. And once, look, I got a black son, a black, I'm sorry, son-in-law, got black babies. Now, I know, turned to her and said, now, I know I can't change your thinking. And the point I noticed was none of them, even though they didn't agree with her behavior, had the gumption to just say to her, you're wrong. It's like the thing with Pocahontas, so I like to call her that. You know, I'm a native Cherokee, but I can still go back and put on my wig and I'm a white gal. But you can see where people, they know things are wrong. They consider death penalty is good for people, or you know, we can't do this in a law. Go down to the traffic court and find out how to burn you up. But the point is, somehow these people can't bring themselves to say, this is wrong. I just want to add that in. And this is one of, this I saw just Saturday. I couldn't believe it. And not that I really disagree with her, because I can understand where she's coming from. But the point is, the people who sat there were squirming and just, they still would not risk their credibility with their constituents. So that's all I got to say.
Well, thanks for calling in and contributing today. Peter from New York, you're on the air.
This is very many of the callers. And you know a lot more about what's happening in the media than I do. But one of the piece of media that I check in with quite often is Democracy Now. And I heard this morning that it's recently been revealed that Trump and his cohorts were actively looking for people to invest in the Amazon rainforest in Brazil. And so maybe some of the European leaders are a bit upset about that. I mean, a little minor crime that he's pulling here is he's putting the continued existence of the whole planet at further risk. We're in serious trouble when not only is the Amazon burning, but also the Arctic has been burning. There's possibly another reason why the media sentiment is coming around to more obviously opposing Trump or pointing out his bizarre behavior or making it more apparent to all of us. But I've also noticed, I've been around for a while, that the media, a conglomeration, the media and the corporate Republicans, corporate Democrats, come around to a realization at some point, a critical mass of realization that the present policy is no longer going to stand, and it's time to change the policy. So that happened with Vietnam. It happened with the U.S. withdrawal support of the Marcos regime in Philippines. It happened with Indonesia and their abuse and destruction of East Timor. So I think we're faced with this type of situation. And I have no doubt that, of course, the economy is a major concern at this point. Trump still has Fox News on his side, and he still has the religious right wing and the business right wing who have some type of a religious devotion to that outlook on life, namely that the essence of life can be determined and should be determined by is any particular activity profitable or not. If it's not profitable, well, then
a reversal. It's going backwards. And just tearing up progress made.
Right.
But insisting on entrenching those things that the nation was eager to get away from.
So not only is there the racism that he's been encouraging, the white supremacist sentiment, but also his withdrawal from all nuclear arms treaties. It's really so dumb, but obviously it's going to benefit the nuclear industry, the weapons manufacturers, and so on. All of his decisions, I think, or so many of them, have been determined by what is going to be profitable for his supporters, you know, his extremely wealthy, isolated supporters.
And for the various sectors that he's appealing to. It's not accidental. He is very much pro-nuclear because I think that there's a group of people, a very small group, comparatively speaking, who want that to be a vibrant part, not just the business of having the capacity to wage nuclear war, but to build all the components. That is employment for his base, employment for select people who are into technology and investment in technology. So that is driving, in large measure, what he sees. Of course, dominance of the world and making it a special ultra-private sector where you make a lot of money, and that is a political base that you're catering to.
And refuse to look at the potential outcome of your actions. I mean, these business-minded right-wing Republicans, and for that matter, corporate Democrats, they like to make their policies based on what they think will be advantageous for them in the future.
Yes.
But, I was talking to this character who owns a health food store and is a pretty prosperous guy, and I already knew his right wing, but I was just for the hell out of it, I was talking about the CO2 content going up like 2 parts per million in 1 year, from 413 to 415 parts per million, and the globe is, as a result, warming faster. And he was, had, for some reason, he had no problem acknowledging that. But then he finished our kind of divisive argument by saying, I just heard of a new report, a new study that's been released by an Oxford professor saying that the globe is going to start cooling now. I said, well, I would like to see that citation. Please show it to me when you get it. But so this guy has some kind of religious as well as a business-minded attachment to Fox News. And so these types of people have an amazing ability just to ignore reality and to ignore studies and research and information from other quarters other than Fox News.
Thanks.
So evidently, Trump still has...
Thanks for calling in. E from Edgewater, we'll take your call. You're the last caller. Are you there? Okay, well, he's gone. You know, I wanted to always encourage people. I always want to encourage people to pay attention to the nuanced things because there's a lot there behind it, you know. It shocked me that there was this sentiment being shared, this tone being shared, the suggestion that people are turning on Trump. who we would not have suspected would do that. And they're becoming more vocal. And it probably signals more than we have talked about today. You know, people, it's things finally coming home to people that you cannot ignore certain things. There are consequences to ignoring things. And especially, they're obvious. But it blew my mind. Of course, you know, from time to time you see media organizations taking a different side and, you know, provoking debate that way. But so many media outlets this past week, and you look at what they're saying, and they're becoming more and more explicit about the fears that they have about where this country is going. And it is not so much a Democrat-Republican axis that we're talking about, but this is the country. This is where we all live, whatever your political stripes. And up until now, you've had some presidents who didn't do as well as they should have, but we never saw something like this. Thanks for calling in. We'll join each other tomorrow, same time. Bye-bye. Mm-hmm.